Thank you. So indeed, I will speak about radiative transfer theory. This is in fact a joint work with Liliana Borchea, Martin De Hoop, and Knut Solna. So to motivate a little bit that work, I will start with a long-term objective, which is an inverse problem, an imaging problem in seismology. We want to image the Earth's interior from the observation of seismic waves. And we are particularly interested into either what we call the seismic coda, which is multiply scattered waves that have interacted a lot with the medium, or even the ambient noise that is recorded between two earthquakes that contains also a lot of information. But let's say today I will mostly think about the multiply scattered waves. Everybody agrees, I mean, mathematicians, physicists, seismologists, agree that those coda waves, those seismic coda waves should contain a lot of information about the medium. And everybody agrees that the radiative transfer theory should describe what happens. But it turns out that the prediction of the radiative transfer equation nowadays do not fit exactly the observations. So that means that before solving the inverse problems, we need to fix the forward problem, that is to say, to determine the correct radiative transfer equation that is appropriate for seismology, which address, let's say, a randomly heterogeneous elastic path space. This is what we want to do. So radiative transfer theory, as you may know, or must know, is a theory that describes propagation of waves in random media, in propagation of wave energy. It is valid when the medium fluctuations have weak amplitudes with correlation lengths that is of the order of the wavelengths. And when you want to look at what happens for large propagation distances. Then the radiative transfer theory is, let's say, well known, well characterized, both by physicists and mathematicians. So at the end of the day, you end up with an equation that describes the evolution of the energy density or the specific intensity. This is a different terms depending on the field, which is in fact the energy density that goes at time t through point x with a transverse with a wave vector, say kappa. And you get this type of equation, so a transport term with a group velocity, and a scattering term, which expresses how plane waves are converted from one wave vector to another one. So this is the conversion rate, sigma kappa gamma prime, the conversion rate of from wave vectors kappa prime to kappa. And you have an extinction rate, lambda k, which is nothing else but the energy that is converted from kappa to all other wave vectors kappa prime. So at the end of the day, you can also write the radiative transfer equation without the extinction rate like that. So this is well known even in physics and mathematics. This is well known provided you don't have any problems with boundary conditions. You are in open space. It turns out that boundary effects may play a very important role. And we do know in seismology that they do play an important role because close to the surface, we deal with a half space in seismology. Close to the surface, you may have some special modes, surface modes, that maybe do not carry a lot of energy, but they, as we will see, play a critical role in the scattering process between the waves. So far, I would say the radiative transfer equations that you do find in the literature, even in the physical literature, are not to be incomplete. So people work hard on it. Physicists work hard on it, and mathematicians work hard on it. And this is what we will do today. I will propose, in fact, two models to try to derive a radiative transfer equation that would be valid for this problem. As we will see, the first model will fail to reproduce accurately the physical observations, but the second one will succeed. Okay, so let's go. So I want to address wave propagation in a random half space. So first, I will consider the case without randomness. So I will consider a half space containing a thin layer that is purely deterministic, non-scattering, that will carry the surface modes that we want to model. So we consider the two-dimensional, here I will only address 2D case, but you could go to 3D easily. We address the two-dimensional wave equation with some source term. Here, the index of refraction is the important part. The index of refraction depends only on the depth. So you may see this is the geometry. Huh? So the surface is here, and Z is the depth. X is the horizontal direction. So what we want is to model surface waves. So we will take an index of refraction that depends only on the Z, and that is maximum close to the surface, let's say equal to N0. Then it decays smoothly up to some depth D, and after D, it's constant equal to 1. We want first to study that problem, that case. So of course, you will, since the problem is the medium does not move, we will study the frequency-dependent version of it. So you take a Fourier transform in time. You end up with a Helmholtz equation with, again, a source term. Okay, no problem. And we want to study the form of the solution to this problem. So here, nothing original. This is well known. I just summarized the main results. In fact, we will decompose the wave solution, the wave field, onto a set of modes, and to determine the modes, we study the one-dimensional Helmholtz equation or Schrödinger equation. That is to say, we forget about the x part. We just look at this operator, second order derivative in z plus k squared and b squared. And we look at the pairs, gamma phi, that are solution of this equation with appropriate boundary conditions at the surface. Here, this is Dirichlet. That is the free surface boundary condition that is valid in seismology. So this problem has been well studied. We know everything. We do know that the spectrum contains a discrete part and a continuous part. The number of discrete eigenvalues is finite. All these discrete eigenvalues lie within some interval, in fact, characterized by the maximum of the index of refraction and the minimum of the index of refraction. Oops, and below, and the eigenfunctions associated to these discrete eigenvalues are L2 function, and not only L2 function, but they decay exponentially in Z. No surprise, below D, NB is equal to 1. So if you take gamma that is smaller than N1 squared K squared, you find an exponentially decaying function. Okay, and below this guy, you get generalized eigenfunctions. Those are the ways that, in fact, oscillates below D, like cosine or sine. So that here, you can hardly see what happens here, I recognize. But here you have, let's say, first eigenmodes. So you can see they may have a few oscillations, and then they decay exponentially. And the orange term here, the orange profile here, is oscillating below D. This is a generalized eigenfunction. So we have this picture in mind that can be used to solve, in fact, the 2D Helmholtz equation. So the important point here, the one that is not completely trivial, is to show that this set of modes is complete. That is to say, when you take all the discrete eigenmodes and the continuous general eigenmodes, you get a complete set of functions, and any function V in L2 can be expanded on this set. So that's the main result that you can find, for instance, in this paper. That's a well-known result for several decades. So as I said, now we want to solve the 2D Helmholtz equation using these results. So what you do is that you will expand the solution of the Helmholtz equation on this basis, on this complete set of functions, phi j of z, the discrete eigenfunctions, phi gamma of z, the continuous eigenfunctions. So you do know that you had as this form. You plug this form into the Helmholtz equation, and you will determine the equation satisfied by the mode amplitudes. So since those guys, phi j and phi gamma, are eigenmodes, when you project you substitute that into the Helmholtz equation and you project, let's say, on one discrete eigenfunction, you integrate by part, and you end up with a fact, due to the orthogonality of the modes, that the mode amplitudes, uj and u gamma, satisfy uncoupled equation, very simple equation, 1D equation here, with a source that depends on the source in the original 2D Helmholtz equation. So now it's very easy to solve. You can solve this equation, that's trivial. So you get at the end of the day, the exact expression of the solution of the 2D Helmholtz equation generated by a source localized at x equals zero. And now you can identify the different modes present in this problem. So you can see that here, we say that we deal with guided modes because the phi j of z is localized in depth. Then it decays exponentially below the small depth d, but it propagates like an exponential, complex exponential function. So it propagates along the horizontal direction over arbitrarily large distance. So this is a trapped mode, a guided mode. This is what we call a surface mode. It's there trapped close to the surface. Here you have the terms that come from the generalized eigenfunction. So remember that this phi gamma is not at all localized. It's an oscillatory function like cosine in Z. So the product of the two, in fact, looks like a plane wave that goes towards the depth, towards plus infinity in Z. So this is what we call the body modes. And the last guys, okay, they decay exponentially. So these are the evanescent modes. They are generated by the source, but they decay exponentially with a propagation distance, the horizontal propagation distance x. Okay, so that means we know everything for the 2D deterministic Helmholtz equation with a special profile of the index of refraction that generates these surface modes. Now we want to address the case where the index of refraction is not only this background profile that supports surface and body modes, but it is perturbed by some random process. So you will add all the necessary hypotheses. It has mean zero, it is bounded, and it possesses some nice stationarity and ergodic properties to make the asymptotic analysis possible. And you introduce a small parameter here, epsilon, that simply expresses the fact that you want to address the case where the perturbations of the index of refraction are small. And you want to study what happens now for the wave U solution of this equation with this index of refraction. So the idea is, okay, we will project, we will decompose the wave field onto the unperturbed modes. Okay, you can always do that because those modes constitute a complete basis. So you can always expand the solution on this basis. The trick is that when you substitute that into the perturbed Helmholtz equation, now the mode amplitudes, the uj and the uj gamma, do not satisfy uncoupled equation, but they satisfy coupled equation due to the small perturbations that you have introduced. And those coupling terms, the CGL, C gamma L, and so on, express the coupling between the different modes. So now the modes UJ can see the other modes, and the mode U gamma can see as well the other modes. So you end up with this system of equations that describe how the wave modes amplitudes are slightly perturbed by these small perturbation U. Now you deal with, second order differential equation in U, J and U gamma. You will transform that into a set of first order ordinary differential equations. So you introduce AJ, BJ, a pair of functions that allows you to rewrite UJ and its derivatives in terms of AJ and BJ. You plug that into the previous equation and you will get a set of equations Okay, I write only one of them because three other ones have the same form. So now you have the first order, the evolution equation for AG that depends on epsilon, small amplitude, and all these coupling terms, CGL, CG gamma, and so on, that allows to express how wave amplitudes, wave can, wave energy can be transferred to from one mode to another one. So of course, here, when you look at the system, if you take the limit epsilon goes to zero, nothing happens because you will get the right-hand side goes to zero and you get exactly the picture that we had in absence of random perturbation. So that means you need to look at long propagation distances so that you will see an effect of order one of this random perturbation. And in fact, the correct scaling is to look at the propagation distance that is of order one over epsilon squared. Because now when you write the new equation satisfied by this rescaled mode amplitudes, instead of having epsilon times C of X, you get one over epsilon C of X over epsilon squared. And this is exactly the right scaling to apply a standard diffusion approximation theorem that allows you to show that as epsilon goes to zero, those guys converge in distribution towards a stochastic process that is solution of a stochastic differential equation or a stochastic partial differential equation. So this is the standard diffusion approximation theory that tells you that. And this is okay because you get exactly these coupling terms that are zero mid ergodic processes in the form one over epsilon C of X over epsilon squared. This is exactly the right scaling to be able to apply this diffusion approximation theorem. So now we are in a position to study the limit situation as epsilon goes to zero. So we have in mind the inverse problem. So our main quantity of interest is what can be measured, which is the normal derivative of the wave field at the surface. So remember, we have a Dirichlet boundary condition, and you measure the normal derivative. This is what you record. We can look at what the physicists call the coherent field and what we call the mean field, the expectation of that field. And when you apply this diffusion approximation theorem, you discover that the expectation of the coefficients A, in fact, decays exponentially with the propagation distance. So this is an expected result. This is known in physics, of course. Physicists expect that there is a loss of coherence and that the mean field decays exponentially with the propagation distance. And the decay rate, in fact, is what they call the scattering mean free path, or let's say the inverse of the decay rate is the scattering mean free path. And here we have a full expression of that guy in terms of the two-point statistics of the random medium fluctuations nu. So I will not write it because here, all I wanted to show is that, okay, you have an exponential decay of the coherent field, which means that after some propagation distance, what you observe is a zero mean incoherent field. So don't try to filter what you observe to try to extract some coherent information. The coherent information is zero. So the information is not in the coherent field. Obviously, it is in the incoherent field. And to characterize an incoherent field, you need to go to higher order statistics. That is to say, not to look at the first order moment, but to look at, say, the covariance function of the wave field. And in fact, this is where the Wigner transform of the normal derivatives of the field comes, because in fact, you could look at the covariance function, both in space and in frequency, or in space and in time. By a Fourier transform, you can play with one or the other one. You don't look exactly at the covariance function, but at the local Fourier transform of the covariance function. So you look at a midpoint that is far, a distance one over epsilon squared, and you take an offset x prime minus x prime, I mean, x prime plus two minus x prime over two, same thing in frequency. And you take a Fourier transform in x prime and in omega prime. That gives you an object that is therefore the local Fourier transform of the field covariance or the Wigner transform that the physicists know exactly. This is what they call the energy density that goes at time t over epsilon squared at points x over epsilon squared with a frequency omega and with a longitudinal wave vector kappa. Yes?
No, question just to Just to understand, so what is random here is the perturbation.
It's a new. The only thing that is random is a random process new that is here.
In practice, you will have just one realization of
yes.
it. So I expect you use some.
Yes, we do have indeed statistical stability. When you go to fourth order moments, you can prove that this guy is statistically stable in this limit epsilon goes to zero. So indeed, this is a result that we know how to prove. Okay, so this is the Wiener transform. And again, we have a field characterization of that guy. In fact, we have a field characterization of all moments because the limit of this of the solution of the equation satisfied by the mode amplitudes are stochastic partial differential equation whose moments satisfy closed equation. So the first order moment satisfy a closed equation. The solution is just an exponentially decaying function. The second order moments will satisfy a closed equation. And in fact, we will get a radiative transfer equation. And higher order moments satisfy also closed equations that you can also study and show that in that limit, in fact, the fourth order moments behave like the square of the second order moments, more or less. So this is the result. So of course, when I say limit as epsilon goes to zero, the limit is in the sense of distribution. This is a weak limit. Huh? This is not a strong limit. This is a weak limit, but it's just enough to give us the result that we anticipate. We find that the limit that I call WS can be expressed in, also remember, we have discrete modes. So in fact, this translates here into the fact that this Wigner transform is a sum of Dirac distribution in the longitudinal wave vector that depends on these eigenvalues, beta j. And the individual Wigner transform for the jth mode, the energy density carried by the jth mode is solution of a set of coupled radiative transfer equation. So this looks like indeed, this is a transport term, of course. And this looks like the radiative transfer equation, but with discrete scattering cross section because we deal with discrete modes. So instead of having a continuous integral here, you have a sum, but this looks like definitely a radiative transfer equation and you can discuss in physical terms, all these terms. So beta j is what they call the phase velocity. Remember, these are the eigenvalues of the one-dimensional Schrödinger operator. The vj here is the group velocity. In fact, it's related to the frequency derivatives of the beta j. The gamma jl expresses the conversion of energy or power from one mode to another one. And here you have the extinction coefficient that takes into account not only, this is not only the sum over L of the gamma GL, there is an additional term. So this is the scary slide. This is where you can express all these coefficients, in particular gamma GL and lambda J, in terms of the two-point statistics of the random medium fluctuations. So you can see, you look at the two-point statistics, the two-point covariance of the random medium fluctuations. You project it onto the eigenmodes of the unperturbed system, and those guys appear in the scattering cross section. So here you can see this is the only thing that is really important. You have an expression of the scattering cross section from mode L to mode J here, and you have an expression of the extinction coefficient that is the sum of those guys. This is what you would expect in a standard radiative transfer equation. But you have a plus something. And in fact, this guy expresses some loss of energy from the surface modes to the body modes. And this energy is lost. You do not recover it anymore. It goes towards the depths. You don't recover it. And since we only have a result in a weak sense, this system of equation expresses some loss of energy that is lost towards the bottom. So this is a nice system, but obviously you will lose something. So you can determine what is the overall prediction of this system. So I would say the transport part is a standard. So to remove the transport part, I integrate in time the energy density. then I just get this system of equation for the min mod powers. This is a very simple system now. It's a, in fact, it's a system of linear ordinary differential equation. So we do know the solution. The solution is, can be written in matrix form. You just have to introduce the matrix M that expresses what is in the right-hand side here. You take the exponential of the matrix and you get the expression of the solution. So you just need now to analyze this matrix M, because we do know it exactly, to determine what happens. Okay, this matrix M has a nice form. It's a positive matrix. You can apply Perron-Frobenius theorem. It has a simple isolated eigenvalue, lambda one, with an associated eigenvector that has, let's say you select the one that has only positive coefficients by Perron-Frobenius theorem. And so you do know at the end of the day that for large propagation distance, you reach, you see only, in fact, the top eigenvector, the eigenvector corresponding to the top eigenvalues. All the other ones decay exponentially faster. And so at the end of the day, you only see a surface mode power distribution that is proportional to the V1. And it turns out that the V1, when you look at that, is not uniform. And this is not what the physicist observed. So you observe that the mean mode power distribution should converge to something that is proportional to that eigenvector V1, which is a quasi-equilibrium state that is not the equipartition distribution state. And for the physicist, there is something wrong because they do observe equipartition of energy. So this is a summary of what I have said so far. So the Wigner transform of the normal derivative of the wave field observed at the surface has this form. It satisfies the system of radiative transfer equation, but we have shown that energy is lost to the body modes and it does not come back. You do not have any coupling back from the body mode to the surface modes in this asymptotic result. You have a strange quasi-equilibrium distribution that is not the uniform distribution. So for all these reasons, the physicists say this is not a good model. It does not capture what we observe in practice. So we would need to change the model to observe something that is closer to what is observed by the seismologist. So to do that, we change a little bit the model. So we again look at a two-dimensional setting. First, without randomness, I remove the randomness again. But the main difference here is that I consider that at some depth capital D large, I introduce a boundary condition. So let's say a Neumann boundary condition. So in fact, and again, the index of refraction at the same form. It's maximal at z equals zero at the surface, it decays and then it becomes constant. In fact, this is a flat Earth model. If you take an Earth model, it should be on a sphere, you make it flat. So you have the free surface boundary condition and at the center, you have a normal derivative that is zero. So that looks like a flat Earth model. So we will revisit the analysis that I have done in this setting. So again, take a Fourier transform in time. That's a little bit simpler to analyze. And again, study the spectral problem associated to the one-dimensional operator. In this domain, 0d. So we will take d goes to infinity afterwards, but here d is fixed with two boundary conditions at z equals zero and z equals d. This is, in fact, a much simpler problem than the one in the half space, because this is really a standard Sturm-Longin theory. See, say here the spectrum is fully discrete. There are only discrete eigenvalues. You can still, now you can see them. It's the same picture as before, but you can see better. Here you can see almost the same picture. Here you can see the different types of modes that you can observe. You have some modes that oscillate. Let's say within the top depths, the top layer, say where the index of refraction is varying. And within this layer, you may have oscillation, but outside this layer, you decay exponentially to zero. And of course, you have also other eigenmodes. They are square integrable because you just have a finite depth, but they are oscillating. for the gain below after z equal d, which is 0.2 here, the index of refraction is constant, so you do know the solution of that guy. So you have a cosine sine function here. And again, the set of eigenfunctions here is complete. But this is really standard spectral theory here. It's much easier than in a half space. So now add some randomness. Assume that you have a little bit of random perturbation, nu of xz with a small parameter epsilon. And now what we will do is we will write a radiative transfer equation for this truncated problem with a fixed d. That is to say, we will take epsilon goes to zero. And afterwards, we will consider d goes to infinity. Note that this is the inverse that we took in the first approach. In the first approach, we first took d goes to infinity, and then we were taking epsilon goes to zero. And the two limits do not commute, in fact. So that's important to realize. So let's go. First take the limit epsilon goes to zero. You get about the same result as before, except that here you don't have any more body modes. So the problem that we had before is fixed. You get a superposition of discrete modes with their particular eigenvalues. And those individual Wigner transform of the Jace mode satisfy a coupled system of radiative transfer equation with, again, a group velocity term that is expected, and coupling between all the modes. But here, the important point is that now the extinction rate is exactly the sum over all coefficients gamma JL for L different from J. That means that no power is lost. Here, I have captured a system that contains all the power. So again, this is nice. But what I want now to do is, this is quite complicated because MD, when D becomes large, MD becomes very, very large. In fact, you have more and more modes that become denser and denser. And this is why we use an old theory. Some people have studied this kind of problems. What happens when you take a sick waveguide and you look at convergence in some sense of the distribution of the eigenvalues and eigenmodes of the sick waveguide when one of the surface goes to plus infinity? And what you find is that you have a finite set of eigenvalues that in fact converges to the eigenvalues of the half space problem. And the other ones become denser and denser, and they converge in some sense towards the continuous spectrum of the half space problem. And so now you can express the radiative transfer, the Wigner transform of the normal derivative of the wave field observed at the surface. You discover that it's the superposition of these surface modes, and also a continuous part that comes from the continuous modes, the body modes. And you have the fuel system of radiative transfer equation that describes this coupling between surface modes, body modes, and you can see that you have coupling in all directions, from a surface mode to a surface mode, from a body mode to a surface mode, from a surface mode to a body mode, and from a body mode to a body mode. So you have all types of coupling captured by this system. And this is really because we took this particular limit, sequence of limit, epsilon goes to zero first, d goes to infinity second. Don't do the opposite, because then you lose most of the terms. And again, here, this extinction coefficient have the right properties that they are equal to the sum of the scattering coefficients, so you don't lose any energy. So the transport, if now I want to spend the last 5 minutes to describe what is the behavior of the solution of this big system. So the transport term is the expected one. These are the group velocities of the modes, no problem. So I will get rid of that by integrating in time so that I get a simplified form without the time derivative. And so now I want to study the behavior of this guy. So as I said, the fact that the extension rate are equal to the sum of the scattering cross section gives that the total power is a conserved quantity. So you don't lose energy. You just transfer energy or power from one mode to another one. But what is this transfer of power? So here you have to distinguish, in fact, different length scale. So first, note that this coupling parameter, the scattering cross-section here, I've not written their fuel expression, but I have written them for the random half space, and this is more or less the same one, so a little bit more complicated, so I don't want to show them. But they are of this order of magnitude. So if the random process nu has a standard deviation sigma and correlation length LC, those guys are typically of this order of magnitude. So now, if you look at the propagation distance that is not too large, of the order of 1/(1) this number, in fact, what remains from this complex equation is exactly what we had in the random half space case. You have only the surface modes that satisfy a closed system with a lambda j, again, that is not the sum of the gamma jl, that is larger than the sum of gamma jl. So this is exactly what we had before. So for short propagation distances, we have this representation, very short, of this order of magnitude. You have this representation of the solution. So it seems that, again, you find that the total mass carried by the surface mode decays, you lose energy, and you have a quasi-equilibrium state, which is proportional to the first eigenvectors of the matrix M. This is what we had before. But in fact, here, you do know here that something happens, is that this energy that is lost is not lost, it just goes slowly towards the body modes. But you have many, many body modes, much more than surface modes. So that's why you don't see them for short propagation distances. When you go to what I call medium range propagation distances, that is to say propagation distances of this order of magnitude, then the picture is completely different. In that case, you find that the surface mode powers is given in terms of this matrix M that we had, is invertible, and something that depends on the body mode distribution. So in some sense, the situation is reversed. The surface mode distribution is dictated by the body mode distribution. And those body modes powers satisfy an effective radiative transfer equation, which was the one we were looking after. Because now we recover a standard, I would say, a standard system in which you have a scattering cross section and an extension rate that is again equal to the integral of the sigma. But what is really important is that the physicist had written this very quickly, and the sigma was just this Brown term, because they have ways to guess in some sense the conversion rate from one mode to the other one. And this is that coefficient. It turns out that by doing properly the analysis, you find that in this scattering cross-section, you have not only the direct conversion from one body mode to another one, but you have a more complex phenomenon, a more complex coupling mechanism, where you can see that you start from a body mode, psi prime, that is converted into a surface mode. Eventually, it may mix with other surface modes, and you have a conversion back from a surface mode to a body mode. And this coupling mechanism, in fact, is as strong as this one. And on the top of it, it can even be stronger when the scattering medium is localized close to the surface, which is typically what happens in seismology. The Earth is rather smooth, let's say, in the deeps, but it's very, very scattering close to the surface. So you shouldn't forget about this term, which plays an important role. So this was for the medium range propagation. Now that you have discovered this phenomenon, you can go beyond the medium range propagation, look at propagation distances that are large compared to this distance, And then you get what the physicists were looking after. You get an equipartition of energy. The energy becomes equipartition between all types of modes, between surface modes and body modes. And that shows something that was also expected. Since you have many more body modes than surface modes, most of the power is carried by the body modes. And okay, this was observed by the physicist. And this is the origin of the main error that was, since most of the energy is carried by the body modes, just forget about the surface modes. They don't carry energy. What we have shown is that indeed, the surface modes don't carry energy, but they play a critical role in the scattering process, in the conversion between different body modes. So those guys shouldn't be forgotten. If you forgot them, your radiative transfer equation, you will write something like that. But with a sigma that is limited to that guy, you will completely forget about this one, can be as strong or even stronger as the original guy. So you really need to revisit the standard radiative transfer equation. Okay, yes, so it's time for me to conclude. So, okay, this is the first step. Remember that my long-term objective is to solve an inverse problem. So this is the first step toward this. We start to have a forward problem, a forward equation that captures the physics of the problem. So we have this original radiative transfer equation that at least involves coupling between all types of modes. In particular, we have this non-trivial, I mean, non-anticipated coupling mechanism between body modes, but which is mediated by surface modes. So don't forget about this one. And so the next step will be, okay, go to the adverse problem. That is to say, if you observe the Wigner transform of the normal derivatives of surface modes, can you infer something about the medium that is inside? So what we want to infer is mostly the background index of refraction or some statistics, some statistical information about the scattering properties of the medium. Of course, this is just in 2D. You have to go to 3D. So it's a little bit more painful, but that's not the critical part. The critical part is to go to the inverse problem. I think I'm done. I thank you for your attention.